great pleasure for me to introduce our latest results. I shortened the title a little. However, it stays the same. I will talk about new routes to highest conversion efficiencies, solar energy conversion efficiencies. And the main target of my talk will be to talk about artificial photosynthesis, water splitting, where we got a new record now. And this is a joint work in a great team together with my group at TU Ilmenau, at Caltech, Joint Center of Artificial Photosynthesis with the group of Harry Edwater, also Achim Liverens, and Fraunhofer Institute of Solar Energy Techniques with the group of Frank Dimroth, and Cambridge University. My former PhD student, Matthias May, is right now there. And yeah, just to repeat this, the outline of my talk addresses epitaxial materials, which make the famous band gap engineering possible. This is thought here to create record devices, record cells, and this we have shown in a teamwork for solar energy conversion. I just addressed this briefly, where the current record is at 46% efficiency, which I find is really impressive. And as I already told, the latest value for solar to hydrogen efficiency, I will explain what this is. And just to address the cost issue, of course, we are strongly working on 3.5 on silicon. There, I'm really glad some hours ago I got the approval for a new grant on 3.5 on silicon. So we will continue to work intense on this topic also. But I think, I fear, I won't come to this topic in depth. However, just to start, I think we had already some introduction in multi-junction solar cells. Everybody of you probably knows that in a normal solar cell, in a standard solar cell, we have great losses, inherent losses, which we cannot avoid. This is due to ultra-fast thermalization of charge carriers due to phonon electron interaction. This happens in less than a picosecond, and also due to transparency losses, since we do not absorb light with energies lower than the band gap. And so the deciding point, I will come to this issue more often, is to create a Fermi level difference between electrons in the conduction bands and valence band. This gives us the voltage we can create in the solar cell, and both is tackled if we are going to multi-junction devices. In such a multi-junction device, I have to distribute the current over different cells. However, I get a higher voltage, since I can sum up all the different voltages created in each subcell, so that I have two different advantages. One is I have lower inherent losses, and in addition I get a much higher voltage. So, and due to concentration, I have an additional increase if I use this as concentrator solar cells. So this is the point. I can sum up all the Fermi level differences to a summary of the sum of the voltages. So, and how do we do this? We have this landscape. Yesterday we had already a very good introduction by Professor Hennini. He's not here now, I see. So we have the opportunity to change band gaps, not only band gaps, but also band offsets. But this is an easy picture about this point. And in addition, we have the choice of different band gaps. This is, for example, the optimum band gaps of a four-junction solar cell. This we already suggested 10 years ago. And this is afterwards realized. Here in the first step, with 44.7% together with Fraunhofer, ESA, Helmholtz Center, TIA Leti and the company Soitec. Here we combined two different tandem cells. Each of them is lattice matched, the established gallium arsenide, indium gallium phosphide one, and the lower band gap here, which we developed combining the band gaps of 0.7 and 1 eV with indium gallium arsenide phosphide. So this was the new point and brought us to this contour plot where the top cell is fixed and the bottom band gaps are have here this variation, and we see we are almost in the bull's eye here. So this value was increased afterwards to 46% at 500 suns here, but there is potential to get it also towards 50%. So, and the good thing here, this I just wanted to show, is these cells as concentrator solar cells, you can directly introduce into modules, which has already been done here. This is data from Soitec. So we are almost at 40% efficiency of, we are talking about module efficiency. This is really impressive, I find, and there is still space to improve this, and this is just a picture how to use this. I like this because of the usage of the land besides the cells. So this is just to show these cells can really directly put into the field. It's a pity that this concentrator photovoltaics is not stronger in the application as it is actual at some sites, like here in South Africa, for example, with 44 megawatts. And the performance of these fields is really impressive. They are highly reliable. This is, I believe in this concentrator photovoltaics with this very high efficiencies and the application. And we have also pieces of art in there. This is in China, a field with 50 megawatts. So, however, I want to come to the real point of this talk. We also will see that we have to use multi-junction solar cell for this. What we are addressing is to use sunlight to create fuels. So this solar fuel production is, of course, a strong point, which we would like to have. This is the solution of all problems which we tackle: storage, mobility, so everything what we would like to have. There is usually two ways to do this. We can do this directly, or we can do this via this detour here, produce electricity, and the electric power drives the PV electrolyzer, which also could be done by a nuclear power plant or a coal plant or whatever. So what we are addressing is this dream. So this is this artificial photosynthesis mimicking the nature, making directly fuel out of sunlight. And I will show, besides the device here, we need desperately a multi-junction solar cell to do this efficiently. We have more challenges here addressing the interface at this cathode here. We are producing via this process hydrogen, and on the other side at the anode we are oxidizing water, and via this oxidation we are creating also oxygen, as the plants, nature also does it in photosynthesis. And just this is if you do not illuminate this devices. This is it possible, maybe just to show what it really means. If you illuminate the whole thing, then you can see here this device. This is a real artificial leaf. There is no wire to the outside, and just by shining light on this device here, you are just creating solar fuels. You can directly directly use it. You told me some minutes ago how people are directly using this hydrogen for, what was it? To say this. Yeah. Also, of course, costs are always an issue. Yeah. So this is currently the target at the European, in the European community. However, to get to real competitive costs of fuels, yeah, we have somehow to address this value here. And what we see here, yeah, this is the expenses we have for the cell itself, and this is the efficiency. And if we are in the blue range here, means this is dollars per kilogram, we have to see that this has a very high power density, the the hydrogen. So what we see here is that we have to get to, of course, high efficiencies on the one hand. This is currently the value which we reached. And also, of course, to low costs, which I already addressed with the issue 3.5 on silicon. And just to see this here, in this range right now, silicon photovoltaics is located. So it's not completely hopeless to think about competitive costs via this way here. Okay, so just explaining the tasks which we have to solve. The first thing, the most important, the mandatory point is to have the appropriate chemical potentials. This is what we always have to regard. We have to regard the Fermi levels, the chemical potentials of electrons and holes. These have to be higher than the difference of the redox potentials for reduction and oxidation of water. This is the first most important point. And if we just use a single solar cell, we see with just one absorber, one junction, then we see that it is basically hopeless to get efficient, since we can just, this is a very positive picture, it basically should show much less blue area here. Since we need require band gaps larger than at least 2.1 eV, even larger. So we wouldn't exploit the sunlight, the spectrum, in a useful way. So what do we have to do? Same thing. We have to go to tandems. But here is the effect much huger compared to solar cells, since now we have the opportunity, firstly, to split water and to exploit the solar spectrum considerably. This is very important. I will show this here on a device. What you see here, just in this great animation here, you see that we are firstly generating electron hole pairs in two different subcells. Then the charges are directed into different directions. And here in the middle, we have isoenergetic recombination here of electron hole pairs. So this shows us the important current matching of these two subcells. And finally, we can oxidize water at the anode and reduce the hydrogen ions here with electron injection from the, that we have to regard from the solid into the electrolyte. This is, of course, a challenge. I will also explain. Now, just to show the theoretical limits to exploit the solar spectrum, what we see here in the top cell, the variation of the band gap, and at the bottom cell, the variation of the band gap here. This is a theory here, published by Xu Hu and Nate Lewis and co-authors. And what we see here, if we are in the bull's eye, we can get close to 29, close to 30%. And it is necessary to be high enough. I will show this in the next slide. Here we see it. In difference to photovoltaics, it doesn't make sense here to get to increase the voltage after having enough. As we have seen this here, after having overcome the barrier of the difference of the redox potentials. So this is what we have to do. Afterwards, we just have to maximize the current here to get to high efficiencies. The solar to hydrogen efficiency just counts the current times the difference of the redox potentials for water, the famous 1.23 volts. And this is divided by the incoming power. This gives us the so-called solar to hydrogen efficiency. This is the theoretical limitations for this. And what we realized now is with this device here, 19% of this solar to hydrogen efficiency. This is achieved by using this tandem cell made out of gallium indium phosphide, metamorphic drone on gallium arsenide, and in addition, the gallium indium arsenide is grown metamorphically onto a gallium arsenide substrate and gallium indium phosphide with a band gap of around 1.75 eV. This gallium indium arsenide has a band gap of around 1.26 eV here. This is the heart of the photoelectrochemical cell here. And then we have here the interfaces to the electrolyte. On the one hand here, ruthenium oxide towards the electrolyte at the anodic interfacial reaction to create oxygen, and here to create hydrogen. We have here this rhodium catalyst on top. The light comes from here. So this is the dark side of this PEC device, and this is the illuminated side of the of this cell. So some more details to this cell here. As I told, the deciding point here besides the tandem here in this black box is to create interfaces to the electrolyte. So we have a solid liquid interface here which is stable and does is basically the electron transfer or the hole transfer at the different reaction sites here, not preventing or slowing down. So we have two points. The most important point, of course, is stability. I will come to this point of these critical interfaces. Here, this is the critical interface of the illuminated side, where we did have this tandem. And then we put titanium dioxide on this tandem structure, on the aluminum indium phosphide window, which I showed you in the last slide here. So here we have this aluminum indium phosphide window. This was photoelectrochemically modified. And then on top of this, we did with atomic layer deposition with the first start with the metal titanium here to have an enhanced adhesion of this layer on top of the tandem, and on top of this rhodium catalyst particles were deposited. This is what we see here. This is the absolute reflectivity on the surface, and what we see is that together with this rhodium catalyst, we increased the transmission, means we increased the transmission, decreased the reflectivity, and we see here a comparison of the performance with cells with rhodium titanium dioxide and just with rhodium without titanium dioxide. So we have different points. One is, of course, the optical performance. The titanium dioxide here acts as anti-reflection layer. And in addition, of course, the chemical stability and the electronic passivation. So this interface has to fulfill a lot of points. This is electronically, we don't want to have interfacial recombination, which basically reduces the voltage and the efficiency. Secondly, we want to have chemical stability, so chemical passivation. And of course, these optical points here, also important. So this is really a strong task for this critical interface here. So just to put these results in a conjunction to the latest results here, or let's say the last record cells, this is not, this here is almost 20 years ago. This was this 12.4%. This was actually achieved with concentrated light, and it was UV light, so this was different with regard to the illumination. These results here were done with simulated solar light, AM1.5. And what we see here in the last 3 years, this is a value which we achieved here in 2015. And afterwards, National Renewable Energy were motivated to also do a new trial and created this result published in Nature Energy. Right now, we are publishing our value, which is considerably higher. I think this is really promising. Just to put it in this effect of stability is, of course, the strongest point here besides efficiency. Just to show this, we did different experiments either in pH zero. And pH 7. So what we see here is that if we regard the current over time to 20 hours here, we see that we have a strong decay of the performance of the current if we are at a low pH value, since titanium dioxide is not stable at this low values. So we need to go to higher pH values, which we did. So at that value, the efficiency dropped to 18.5%, but still a very good value. At 15 milliamps per square centimeter. This is put here in comparison to all the latest results. I already mentioned there is some three electrode measurements of over a long time with low currents here. This is the work of here Verlage and co-authors. This is our value, the red one. This work here, two electrodes set up, measured over 20 hours here with 15 milliamps per square centimeter. And this is here the record of Enril, this two electrode set up, the black curve here, the rest is either three electrode set ups or just this low current here from the Verlage group. So what we have to see here, for example, if we go to lower values, lower current densities, we have a real stable performance here over 20 hours. So this is all pretty promising. I don't know how is time now. I could, of course, now 5 minutes. Very good. So this is the efficiency, and stability, all these points which are really relevant for a working device. The point of costs is one driving parameter for all kinds of devices. We learn this at all kinds of device relevant research. And the point here is to combine C5 and silicon. C5 and silicon is basically combining the working horse here together with an upgrade of this working horse by C5s and all the virtues of the famous bandgap engineering possibilities. And in addition, this is also a very good combination. This is the bandgap of silicon, here the black line here, in combination with different bandgaps of a potential top cell here. And what we see here in relevant ranges here, we can go almost to the bull's eye also of the efficiencies. This is shown for photovoltaics, but almost the same picture we get if we go to solar water splitting. To combine silicon with 3.5s in the range of around 1.7, 1.8 eV, which for example could be done by gallium arsenide phosphide compositions, would basically address the bull's eye here of this contour plot of the theoretically highest efficiencies. And here we put really a lot of work in. I just want to briefly introduce into this. I won't come to the latest results we got, but I just want to show you the route, how to get there. And I think this is also hopeful. I already addressed these points, the great advantages of 3.5s. And the great advantages of silicon here, together with these this landscape of opportunities for bandgap engineering. But we have challenges. These challenges here are the growth of a non-polar material, silicon, just with one atom per unit cell, and polar materials where we have the 3.5s, which of course have two atoms, two different atoms with two different valences in each unit cell. And this makes brings a principal problem I would like to show you briefly on the next slide. In addition, of course, we have to deal with the topic of different lattice constants, but this is doable. There is the current record cell is a metamorphic cell with different lattice constants, and also the different thermal expansion coefficients here for silicon. The good news is this system here is similar, and this is perfectly working. So this 3.5 on germanium growth is basically getting to the highest theoretical efficiencies, very good comparable to 3.5 on 3.5 growth. The difficult thing is now how to do this and how to understand this and to watch it. And this we did in the past. Just to show this, there is a lot of interaction between hydrogen and the surfaces of silicon and 3.5s, if we go to metal organic chemical vapor deposition, and this addresses basically just last slide, then I will stop here, the approach, how to get there, which we do by just watching during growth with in situ spectroscopy, which is easily to adapt. And in our case, we understand these in situ signals by benchmarking these with a lot of surface and interface science tools, so that we finally really understand the interfacial atomic structure quantitatively. This I would show at the next opportunity, yeah, just to briefly show you the difficulties to do this, but I think this is a great target for the whole optoelectronic world, not only solar energy conversion devices, but also electronic. This is basically addressing more than Moore, this enhancement of electronic and optoelectronic devices. So I will summarize my talk. Just to conclude, I was not showing a lot about 3.5 on silicon. This would have been too much today, but highly interesting. I was rather addressing this solar fuel production, this water splitting device, very exciting. And here we got a new record again, and this is something. This is very important to thank for the financial support and all the partners in Ilmenau, Cambridge University, Helmholtz Zentrum, in Czech Republic. We have great, we got right now the grant together with Alex Romaniuk, Fraunhofer ISE, Azure Space, Caltech, and the University of Wien. Thank you for your patience.